Afternoon. Thanks for coming back, and let's start into the session that was last yesterday on Galaxy. Just a quick question before: how many of you know already Galaxy? ¿Cuántos conocen ya Galaxy? Okay, let's start then. What is this good for? So, as we have noticed on our own experience, possibly before, and also on the first and second day, installing all the bioinformatics tools is quite a headache often, different operating system, and not all programs can be run on every system. Then we noticed also on the second day, it's also another big headache just to learn all the different interfaces for each program or for the library. Even if it's in R, for example, with for each library, there's a little bit difference between the different tools. And also, as pointed out, one big workload for bioinformatics guys usually just to clean the data and to transform the data. And also just to document the data. I mean, we learned nice tools yesterday, but still, you know, it's another learning curve. And what would be better than to have someone else not taking care of you, because you are firsthand by heart and biologist, you just want to get on with analysis. No? Not so much about, you know, learning all these additional tools. So there was a problem, you know, early on recognized, and there were different approaches already in, on making bioinformatics a little bit easier. No? And it's more and more important because nowadays the computational resources you need nowadays for NGS or metagenomics analysis are not that easily available often enough at your own institution, or if you're starting out as a student, you just may not have access. So that's another big hurdle, no, to bioinformatics, if you don't have even access to the computational basic resource. So that's where tools like Galaxy come in. So Galaxy is lots of things, but in the first place, it is a free cluster server with a web-oriented interface. So it's not only one server or one entry. There's more than 125, because now there are different institutions around the world that put on their own expertise into a uniform interface based on simple web forms that are very much standardized across different galaxies. And they form also often a very task-oriented subgroups of bioinformatics tools. So maybe there's one cluster only dedicated to assembly, another one to phylogenomics, another one for metagenomics, and so on. So it means also the Galaxy community as such has also made it possible for everybody basically using a standardized interface to be able to extend it with your own tools. And you can also download the whole software and install it on your own cluster preferably, but it also can be run for testing purposes even on your laptop. So if you want to play around as a bioinformaticist, we said you can do it even on a normal laptop. And well, one of the big selling points from the very beginning was that it makes it possible to move data transparently from one tool to the other. So this big headache, you know, of transforming data between tools is greatly taken care of. And another big selling point from the very beginning of on was that it makes it possible to visualize this in a workflow. So it's kind of what we touched upon also in the second day, kind of visual programming. So instead of typing and typing code, you just drag and drop more or less, no, your favorite tool and tool sequences into a workflow. And even better, you can share those workflows. And you can share them also with journals. So even people publish Galaxy Workflows as a product as such. So there's lots of pluses on the side, but obviously the downside is you need at least internet connection. Otherwise, if you're in a country that doesn't have that, or you're in a low connectivity region, that's also a hindrance. Also, the main point for transport, it's just for transporting data into it. Once you have your data in the cloud from Galaxy, it's relatively easy to move on with Galaxy LNSs. That depends on each server. So there's one main entry site, but it's that was for years ago was also really a bottleneck. So that people, more people requesting resources than there were resources available on the server. But then they got more resources apparently, and also they multiplied basically, you know, spreading the load between different servers. So we go in this a little bit in a moment. So one of the reference publication here was in 2010, I think, no, from the very first. I should also say, so Galaxy, as I mentioned, is not the only tool. No, there are several others, but Galaxy is, I think, definitely the best known tool for these visual working tools. And I think over the time, over the recent years even, there's more and more competition coming up, trying to beat Galaxy into some aspects. Right, so this is one of the typical workflows you can basically achieve with Galaxy. Doesn't really matter, this one is just also from a recent paper, more or less, no, from making phylogenetic and phylogenomic analysis available with Galaxy. And as you see, it looks at least a little bit more accessible usually than just code. And you can see also now how the different data parts basically are moved between the different sections of the algorithm there. Okay, so here I just Googled the Galaxy, this 2010 publication, and it has more than 3,000 citations. So this is something not that easy to achieve, so it shows some popularity. So as a bioinformatician, you dream of this, usually. But let's look at the timeline. So here our famous graphic from yesterday, but I cheated a little bit, no, that I modified it. I used the Google citations because Galaxy may be not a term that is so unique even. Anyhow, so just from those you see, now the last couple of years, there is a little bit of a downfall of Galaxy. But for me, it doesn't not replace, basically, it does not mean that Galaxy is getting out of fashion really. I think it more means that there is more competition. So like from other tools here, one is a Globus automated architecture with other purposes in mind, but basically it's also Globus automate cloud service, which I think tries to go a little bit more beyond by simple bioinformatics. So more into more, even more heavy applications. And yeah. But as you say, just to make the point again, so Galaxy is definitely citable even in Nature, and also recent publications, no, from this year. So there's still lots of research going on actual problems. So it's an active community. So that's what you want to know also, as we all pointed out during our talks. You want to make sure when you work, when you try to work yourself into learning a new tool, that it's worthwhile at least for another year and not out of fashion tomorrow. So better to make sure that we're still on track with some tools. So as I mentioned, one of the attractive parts. So how does Galaxy get all these tools in there? Basically, it's also reuse of tools that already exist. So they basically have specialized wrapping software. Now they have even switched to Conda, for those you know. Basically, Conda is a generic, you know, command line oriented and Python based wrapping tool, you know, to manage all the dependency of all the different tools, basically no matter what the language is and what are the dependencies. So Galaxy uses this, this also as a backend, but puts on top a graphical way to generate the interface for the web in a standard way, and also to make the data transportation between the different basically subunits of Galaxy accessible in a standard way. So make it easy to connect the data flow between different tools. And then on top of it, it definitely has some also other magic tools, Node-to-Run tools, across a cluster in an efficient way. So this is what it basically makes the setting up of a Galaxy server also a little bit more interesting, and to say it positively, because you have to manage this kind of sharing, load sharing tools also, when you want to put Galaxy on a web server. So setting it up on a laptop is pretty easy and straightforward, but setting it up on a cluster is another story, just to make sure. But it's easy then to explore also how you could put your own tools, maybe from R, into Galaxy. So how would that look like? So we would have just maybe a simple add function, like I also pointed out, no, add number one, number two, and then you can write a wrapper around this using another helper library from Bioconductor, and you can generate an interface like this, simply to add the two numbers. So it looks like a lot of overhead. It is actually, but it is just to show how you can wrap your own tool to be part of the Galaxy universe, so to say. So there is also what's called a repository for tools, you know, that are basically already wrapped for Galaxy. They call it tool shed. And thank you. And this tool shed has right now more than 6,600 tools available there. Many of them are active from R, from each of the statistical analysis. And basically, that is also where you can register your own tool if you wanted to. So some examples of dedicated servers. You know, the question is, you know, which, lots of interest, you know, the server will also go down. So there are alternative servers. There is a standard server here, you know, usegalaxy.org. But now there's a strong new community from Freiburg in Germany. For Europe, they've been setting up their own Galaxy cluster server. And you see they're getting up to date always, also even on the general purpose server with latest technologies on nanopore data analysis. So it's also metagenomic analysis. So lots of tools already available on the standard server, not all the 6,600, because it would be just too much of a load also for that server, I guess. Yeah, just to show. So it's also a little bit for assembly, but you see it looks only very small, and it's only for your bacteria, basically. No, for us, yeah, even a little more interesting is if you can do or find some servers for plant genomics. There are two I know about. One is from France, from INRA, called South Green Bioinformatics Platform, oriented towards some of the tropical crops CIRAT and INRA are working on. And another one is from the International Rice Research Institute for rice analytics, but also, as they write on their own page, this may be a bit shaky, so it is not really a public resource. It's much more like doing occasionally maybe a bioinformatics analysis. That, and maybe, as I said, always good to have different tools in your back of the mind, you know, when you want to do certain tasks. As you know, by now possibly I'm a huge R fan, but there are still some things you can't do in R. And one of the key things you can't do in R or Bioconductor yet is de novo analysis. So this also simply because usually, you know, on your own laptop, you will be getting out of time before you die. So definitely it's good to have access to some free resources, you know, if you don't have your own cluster in your own institution. Then there is at least one server I found from the page called GigaGalaxy that claims to be available for the Nova assembly. I haven't tried that yet, but so it looks promising at least. So let's jump into what about learning Galaxy. So I hope for the rest of the day we will have internet access. But there is also from the main Galaxy page quite a set of tutorials available, and for different purposes. Several of them are quite closely oriented towards standard workflows, But some of, many of them are already a little bit oldish, 2014, 2013. So, but at least gives you an idea of the main steps, you know, the new area to get going. But definitely you should update yourself if there's something more new on certain topics. But at least you get the idea. And so that's sort of the best way to get to know Galaxy. So right now we start into using Galaxy on the web. Just make account of the SNP, account of SNPs on the over the chromosome 22 and find the exon that has the highest number. So kind of typical simple question, but it serves you know to get yourself accustomed with the basics of Galaxy, learn how to obtain data from the external sources, run tools. Very important here how to make your history, so that's basically getting a visual program. And then how to create a workflow is basically to get a reusable program, but in a visual style. So you only have to basically to click and drop and make occasionally a few changes in a name. And that's it basically. And this take the whole tutorial takes about an hour and a half, so it's just fine for today. Yeah, so let's go through this one by one. I hope you get, okay, you have been locked out, so everybody, I got on my hotspot here, so let's get at least to the login, but that logging in and getting yourself a name, I guess that's straightforward. And so please just get yourself a name, because that is important, because you need that user ID to be able to put your steps into the history. Later on we will see what is the important step here. So but just here so we get a little bit to know the interface. So here on the left hand side you have all your tools and they are organized here in groups. So if you click here on one of these you get lots of sub tools. Much too much to remember. So you have also your top search box like NGS or something and then you get at least a little bit more filtered options there. And you see here also on the very public survey here that there is quite a lot of options on tools that are already available there. Well, here in the middle is the one area where you later on have the forms. Right now, this is on the straightforward landing page here. And on the right-hand side, this is where you basically the tool registers all the history of your steps, pretty much like RStudio does. But it allows you also to make a reusable workflow out of it, and then later on create this visual steps in a like graphical map-based interface. So let's go through the tutorial here. So again, so what we want to match is what we want to get is the number of the chromosome that has the highest number of SNPs, and the on the chromosome, sorry, the exon that has the highest number of SNPs. So how do we get started here? Now give yourself a new history, and to show that. Usually we have here on the right upper corner this history. You see there are lots of options. We get to know a few of them today. So we just use create new just to state R. And then you can click here on this line unnamed history and you give it a name according to the tutorial that would be Galaxy 101. Just type in Galaxy 101 and enter, and then you have a history, which is right now empty. So then we go to the part in a step, load, upload data from OverZap. So this is another neat feature. So you don't need to download the data from somewhere over the web if it's already on the web on a public known address. You can just basically paste in even a URL, you know, where is your data hosted. If you have a laboratory for you, you know, creating files, they usually give you a address where you can access it, usually via command line wget or something like that. But you could also just use that link and paste it into Galaxy, and it would download it. And there are some other well-known databases in the Galaxy sphere of influence, like UCSC, where you can go directly also into the database via Galaxy plugin, so to say, and it allows you to download the data from that database, no, into Galaxy. So that's what we do now on Galaxy main. So we get data, UCS main. So get data, and then we have to write the second entry here. So we're kind of shamelessly promoting the fans. And okay, so this would be opening now the UCSC genome browser. And so there's lots of options here, so also they're confusing always. So let's stick to the tutorial here, what we want to do. And now we see we need to set the following parameters. Clade mammal. Okay, that's already there. Clade mammal here. Then we have genome human. Okay, we are right. Assembly December 2013. Okay, so we are still good. Then we have group, genes and gene predictions. Okay, the second line here, genes and gene prediction is also good. Track gene code version 24. Okay, now something to change here. Version 24. And then we have table known gene. Sorry, known gene table. Okay, next thing to change. Where do we have? Table. Apparently the tutorial a little bit out of date here. Known gene, no, let's look something here which looks compatible. Basic, I would see that would be should be compatible here. And region should be changed to position with value chromosome 22. So genome. Yeah, definitely. I mean, you can follow the tutorial better maybe in your room over in your hotel than, I mean, wasting time here now on the internet. So let's try to get to it. But I see it's a little bit out of date since the last time I also went through this. So let's see. Genes and gene prediction is a group. The track should be gene code, gen code, version 24. So that looks okay. And then table, known gene. Okay, this is a one already question, what is known gene? It doesn't have it anymore, so it either between basic or comprehensive. So I think maybe it goes to comprehensive. And then we have, this is a human genome. No, no, for this example, we follow the example. The example is we want to find the exon with the highest number of SNPs on the human chromosome 22 or in the human genome. Okay, so let's stick to the tutorial for the moment here. So output format, so region should be changed to position and with value chromosome 22. So region is here now, position chromosome 22. And then we have output format should be changed to bed browser extensible data. Okay, that's here. And then the checkbox to send output to should be having the option Galaxy 2. So that's also already done. And then we have click on the Get Output button, and you will see this next screen. So we hope we are still good here. Get Output. Okay, that works. And now we change Create One bit record per two coding exons. So create one bit record. That's here, second line, per two coding exons. Coding exons, it's over here. Yeah. And then on the send query to Galaxy button. So send query to Galaxy button is still also here. Yeah, so this is good, fine, we get a green message. And now what we see here on the right hand side in our history, we have left a mark in history. Our mark in history is here. And so it is still in gray, which you see, and here is in green. What that means, if it's gray, it's still in the gray zone of getting over from the UCC browser to the Galaxy instance. So when it has arrived, it will turn green. So now we have to wait. Luckily, as I said, the Galaxy will directly contact the server. So I'm using here my smartphone, and I don't want to run out of my megabytes. No, so this is gigabytes, possibly. So the good thing is really that I sent only the commands over my smartphone here. No, but Galaxy directly over the internet makes the connection. So it's very, you can even now run a Galaxy instance maybe on your smartphone and do everything from there directly. Eh? Only very small to see, but you could do so if you are just sending the commands. No? Like you would be connecting to a server maybe via PuTTY or some other terminal box. And so this makes life cheap for bioinformatic on the go. Okay, so we just have to wait here. Then we can see a little bit here in the tutorial ahead what we have to do next. So then we can put peek into our data, which is always good, no, as we have seen also on the very first day, no, get to know your data. And so we hopefully, no, sometimes, so this is definitely also by Galaxy, you know, is doing this over the web. We are not the only one possibly on the web right now there. So lots of server load is always to be suspected, also to interplay and interfere with our own interests here. So that is why it's possibly taking a while. But usually in other circumstances, it was faster. So we have to just to be patient here to get on. But once we have the data in here, it's a little bit easier. So just get to drink something or get coffee, usually as we do in the bioinformatics. Anyhow, so maybe I can also try refresh, just maybe to force a little bit the fortune here, but now it's still gray. Okay, let's speak ahead. So it's good to see what we're supposed to do. So I can also make this a little bit bigger here. Oh, it doesn't make the, the table bigger. But basically we see we are to expect a table with like a few columns. The chromosome, like it's a GFF table basically, you know, start, end of something, name of something, and then we have a score and a strand, and that's it basically. You know, each line represents an exon. The first three columns are the genomic location and so on. So then we are to learn, you know, let's rename our data set because that is a very longish name here. So we make something shorter later on. And you see when we click on around here on this interface, we can see even some more details on this particular data set. And the next thing is that we upload SNP information also from UCSC, or hopefully it's a little bit faster the next step. And then that's the thing, then maybe at least then after that we should be redefined then, or better at least, because then we have already the data in here. Okay. Let's try a little bit more. No, still. Yeah, let's just wait. Find extra, then we have our step here. So basically the first couple of steps, the main steps here are just to get the two data sets we want to compare. Now the basic reference genome, chromosome 22, and the list of SNPs. And in the genome reference, we already load the exons there. So we can imagine ourselves a huge collection of exons, and we then just have to match by composition now the two data sets and compare. So that's what's happening next. So here we have then a step to join the intervals of the two data set sides here, and then we are already good to count the number of SNPs per axons. So just get a little bit jumping ahead, and then sorting the axons by count, and then at last we get select the top 5 1, and then we can transport our findings even back into the UCSC genome browser and get a nice picture over here. So where are the highest exons, the exon with the highest SNP numbers? So that basically the main steps. And then what I mentioned before, the really useful path for the future is then to be able to reuse this to a certain extent. Now we can then save our history. So that's usually also a very good thing in itself, because that we can use then later on for publication. And even more, we can convert the analysis history into a workflow. So there's again some tools already, so it's all via interface here. We can edit and modify our history while we are maybe we want to remove something or change something here in the naming, and then save it as a workflow. And then we can basically then also edit that workflow, because it comes basically preloaded in a very standard way, and that may not always be the optimal way to visualize what we have been doing. So we can rearrange our boxes here on a map-based interface quite easily. Thank you. And then you see also we can zoom in and out. If it's a very complex workflow, that's also useful. And later on, now we can then run the workflow on different data sets. So it's good to see that you can basically save on work in the future by making your workflow as modular as possible. Now then can you basically even join different workflows into bigger workflows, all in a very transparent way. And maybe if you are not very fluent in the one or the other area of transforming data or getting data, you may ask a friend. And so it would be also useful if the friend could really look at that workflow, not only via email screenshot, but really live. So you can also share your workflow over Galaxy with the colleague, and then you can work both or several on the specific parts of your own area of expertise, on the optimizing that workflow. And then you can even share it with the general public if you're happy, and also already submitted your article to a journal, then you are very happy. And yeah, so that's basically the main points in this tutorial, and I think that's really are the highlights of Galaxy. So I'm not getting paid by them, but I think it's still a very nice tool. So hopefully by now, still loading here and transporting data. So this is really slow today. It's not only here, but apparently also over there at the Galaxy Head hotspot. Yeah, so okay, let's see what's in more detail. Now we have had a very fast forward what the next steps are to be. So we did this one here, so this is filtering out the data from the human genome, so only the chromosome 22, converting it into a standard format, which is this BAT file for putting like coordinates on a genome and the corresponding other elements of interest. That we got ready to load into Galaxy, and that's where we are now waiting. So When the data set is green, then we can click on the all-seeing eye here. I'm getting itchy here with my fingers, but I think we can do it, but better not to risk now because it takes so long. Yeah, just another. It's a bad day today. We are not on the 13th, no, the 7th of the session. Should be a lucky number. Anyhow. Let's see what is here more on the interface. So when we have done this next step to renaming, it should be something short like exons only. So this makes us easier to also to track then in a workflow, because the workflow with many boxes gets also very busy. So the shorter the names, the better. And then we can set here some attributes according to this interface here. You cannot leave comments. That's something useful, because it would be also showing up in the workflow or the history. So you can start documenting like it would be with comments in a code in R or Python or whatever. Here you see the other tabs, convert format, that also helps you not to already like pre-configure data conversions that are available for this specific element. Then we have also data type we can also change, and also very important is here permissions. So who can access this? So if you have, you can set up your own working group on Galaxy, and also even if you have your own Galaxy on your own cluster, you can also manage various different working groups, and you can manage the permissions then for each data set separately. So, I think what we can do start again also is maybe the second step, because it should be running in parallel. So let's try to load this SNP data. Again, we go to UCSC main, and again open the UCSC main table browser tool. Okay, so get data, UCSC main. And this time, group should be changed to variation. Where's group? Group here. And where's variation? Over here. So there's variation. And region should be changed again to position with value chromosome 22. Region was here. Again, the region should be changed to position, which is there. And again, chromosome 22. Okay, we should be the same. And then output format should be changed again to belt browser extensible format. Output format, belt browser extensible data. And send output. Okay, there's something more here. The track setting shows the version of the SNP database to get. In this example, it's version 150, but we may use the latest one. So where is this? SNP 151. Okay, this is acceptable. Oh, the track setting. Okay, where's the track? Over here. The same, supposedly. Yeah, we are in the latest one. Okay, so we just may expect a few variations in the results from this tutorial. Again, click on the Get Output button to a form similar to this one. Get output, and then make sure that create one batch record per is set to whole gene. That is this one. So, and then click send query to Galaxy. Okay, let's try. So we at least get the green page back. And again, it's in gray. That's still not available. Okay. Maybe it doesn't change to green anymore. That could be something. Let's try. No. So this eye is still, not showing. There we still have to wait. So no data being shown here. And so just be patient here. Okay, at least we have two things hopefully coming back. Okay. So let's go to the detailed here. So the second one we would rename to SNPs. So we can get easier. I don't know if we can do this. I think we can. Let's just try this. Edit attributes or this one. Okay, let's see. Edit attributes. Yeah, so we change this one here. Axons. Save. Yeah, and we edit this one to SNPs. Save. So at least we have our labels done. Okay, so this is actually a nice feature later on, also usually in the Galaxy. You can put basically the steps in place and then it will basically start using as the data become available. So let's try if it works, if it's a very new, fresh data set coming in. Possibly, at least we can do the next step. I doubt about the second one, but to move on. So enter the, so join, there's a tool called join. So it's a little bit too much to remember where it is, in which submenu we might find this. So we just type it in here, join in the search box. And there we have several options and we want to join the intervals of two data sets side by side. Let's see, join two data sets side by side. So it is here the fourth option. So let's see this. And then we select the Axons data set as the first data set and the SNPs as the second. So we have Axons and the SNPs as the second. So that's then make sure that return is set to inner join. Where is return? Where is this return here? Options. No. Keep lines, fill empty lines, side by side. Okay, maybe I'm still joining two data sets. Maybe it was another one. Okay, maybe possibly it's this one here. Join, so axons, and there is a return. So only records that are joined in a join. Okay. In the output. Okay, that's the only thing we have to do here. And click the execute button and view the resulting. So we see we can do this while still the data are loaded. So let's see how far we can go. We can't inspect the data as we've noticed, but we can build the workflow. So let's move on a little bit. So we just have to skip those with the I here, I guess. Yeah. Okay. So now we have some quality checks here. These are the ones with the inspecting, which we can't do right now. So the next step, which we possibly can do, is count the number of SNPs per axon. So that sounds more interesting right now for the purpose of this tutorial. And again, group. So we have to search group here. Group. And group, what we want to have is group data by a column and perform aggregate operation on other columns. This is this one. Group data by a column and perform aggregate operations. So double check here. And then we have join on data 1 and data 2. That's okay. And we should be working on column 4. And that's where we're now running out of our options. Because then, yes, we need to have those data available. So, yeah, we are stuck here. Let's see what is already compatible here. So column 4 is not there yet. Select data, select the output data set from the join tool and group data by column 4, insert operation, click on this and then set type to count and set onto count. Okay, insert operation and type to count. Yeah, so because this is like statistics, no? Several things you can do there, medium, minimum, maximum. And this should begin on column 4, which is not there yet. And then we should see something like this. Okay. Too bad that there's nothing really getting on here with this interface. Okay. This would be the ideal time to take coffee, if it would be ready. Yeah. Okay, so we just have to wait, apparently. Galaxy seems to be busy these days. Maybe be Captain Marvel is coming today or tomorrow. Anyhow, so, yeah. Okay, let's inspect our table. What we are supposed to see now is this table here, which tells us, I think, about the SNPs and the exon IDs. The first contains the exon IDs and the second number of types that ID appeared in the file. Now that is the number of SNPs basically in the second column here. So then we can look into the question of how many exons are there in total in your file. Now, so we just could count the total here. And then we can sort the exons by SNPs count. So similar what you can do on Linux and Unix or in R, now we just sort and order them, on having the most ones on top. And there's also a tool like on Linux command line, which is called sort. So while this is still cooking here, now we just search it up. And then sort data in ascending or descending order. So that this is kind of interface again. So you notice always it's the same kind of similar interface. You get here on top usually the data sources that are available on your right hand side also. And then you get some operations. And usually what I haven't shown yet, always towards the bottom you get also some more documentation. Like in R, what you can actually do here. Like here, it's very nicely documented. So you can get yourself accustomed with it. And even on the bottom, it shows you the correct citation for this tool. And if you want to use that as part of your paper. So it's very accessible, in just also in terms of ease of use, because as I said, the Galaxy tries to standardize as much as possible and make it very easy to move the data from one tool to the next one. So unlike now, if you're seeing in R, you can see it's really easy. You don't have to worry about which library I use to convert. And also it's relatively easy to find the correct tools in here on getting on with the next step. So most of them are having already a description within the menu on the left-hand side. So you have more than one option usually to search. If you don't recall exactly the name, you can just use maybe a term that should be there, and so you are more likely to find something even just by searching here the box on the left-hand side. Yeah, what else? So we have sort, and this wouldn't work right now either, but we can see you would set the order, look the column where you want to sort upon, the ascending or the descending order. Maybe some fine-tuning here on whether it's alphabetical sort or natural sort or number sort. So in this case, it would just basically find our top exons with the most SNPs in it, and that's basically it. So that's problem solved. So now we know this particular exon here from this particular version of the genome, and the SNP count, it has 40. in it. We have one version more, so maybe we have more or less, who knows. And so the next thing is then to restrict the list. No, we don't bother about the other many hundreds or thousands that there might be there. We just want to see our top five. And that's what we then select. We have a tool not to cut, no, like we have a head in Unix and same in R. We get the same, so it's very useful, you know, to get into some of this basic bioinformatics speech or idioms. And so you can also find your way around in Galaxy. Then we just execute, and then our table is suddenly has become very small, not for megabytes or gigabytes that we are now dragging on over the internet connection. We end up with just a few characters. And so then we are done. Which exons on chromosome 22 have the highest number of SNPs? So next question here, what can we learn about them? Putting data into context is then the next step. So we can compare two data sets here. And it then can basically make the cross-reference to the locations of the top 5x. And then we can use that again to put the data back onto the UCSC genome browser. So that again just opens similar, well, first we go here to the database and see that we are in the right version of the human genome assembly for this purpose in this tutorial, HG3838. And from there, so there is lots of options to see the name, some info on the copyright here, again the database build from 2013, and we have also here specifically we can assign the columns to match the expected expectation here on chromosome reference start and end column, strand, and so on. And then, so this is necessary to match it back to the UCSC genome browser. And then, yeah, then we can put it in to the other tracks of the UCSC. So that should be showing up somewhere here. User track near the top. Yeah, okay, that is here, the third line, very small, but no. Yeah, the picture won't show separately here, but yeah, it shows up here. And then again, so on, at least we can see the menu here. So let's switch back here on this menu. So here we have this, first we can save this. We can use this as a saved set of histories. We can have several histories here. But in this case, the next step, what we wanted to do there is here, so we can see here, let's say, if we click on this item icon here on the right-hand side, we see all different histories that are available on your account. So you see I have some more, but so let's stick to this one, and switch. Let's go back here. Yeah, still loading, so it must be, I don't know what's going on today. Yeah, so that's we can switch between histories, and now what we wanted to do was here, that's what I was looking at, the extract workflow. Item we can possibly do this just to see how it looks like right now, extract workflow, and so we can just some data sets circuit are running or not. We hope it's stable enough to suffer my attempt here to just create the workflow. no it will not, of course it's not finished yet. So, but yeah, supposedly with this, yeah, you could create this workflow here, and then we would see how it looks like on the left hand, on the right-hand side. So the right-hand side is the history, and the left-hand side shows you the steps in the workflow that you can reuse. And here you could then decide which whether you would keep that step or not, and you can basically fine-tune here a little bit. And so yet again, as I said, you would be able to click this button, something would happen. And after that, it will be available. So I think I have something from another exercise. So still, and it will show up then, as I said, as so. If you save it as your own workflow, now you see on the left-hand menu panel, now you can save your own genome, your own workflows here. And then they are here available in the center page. I don't know what, let's see. Ah yeah, this was too long ago already. Apparently they made a few changes in between. Anyway, so this is now apparently, yeah. Okay, somehow the warning is very big here. So I'm possibly not able to run this, but just I think you can set are these steps available, but they're all set into gray also, so they won't probably run either. But this, something is already in red right now, so too long ago. Yeah, okay, so your warning to also regularly update your workflows possibly here. And okay, so we have then an option to edit also the workflow as such. Now you would be able to see this workflow you just created from your history, and be able to click on these boxes and drag them around on the map. So maybe top down or left right as you prefer, or bottom up, and to make the lines a little bit more disentangled maybe between some of these steps. So you can put it in the visual order you prefer. And that's basically mainly here to this part. So as I said, with the it helps also that you have a zoom in function here to move around easily on this big map then. And yeah, you can also change again the labels to maybe something more explicitly for publication purposes or for your own benefit. And then just save it, and now we could validate. No, that was always a good idea. Now if it really still works as expected, and then could try this workflow on a different data set. So maybe change the chromosome and see if it still gets a chromosome count of the top exons there, top SNP count on the top exons. So that's basically the main steps on extracting and creating the workflow. And yeah, usually, as I said, once you have the data in there, they should turn green. And then when you run a tool on Galaxy, it should just turn itself, the part here in yellow for a while, and then also turn green. So when something goes wrong, it would turn red and it would stop there. Once green, it would move on to the next step. So until, so basically from bottom up to top, it would turn green if all goes well. So then you can share your work. You can share basically everything. You can share your data set. You can share your local history, your local workflow. You can also generate images. So there are some parts, tools that allow you to generate these graphics. And also those can be made available to other people, either a selected set of users or just for the general public. And that's basically it. So Galaxy provides an easy to use graphical user interface. You get the full record of your history. And yeah, can easily repeat by using your workflow. But as we noticed today, It depends now on both on the availability of a good internet connection just to get there first, and then it depends on low enough workload on the Galaxy server itself that you can actually get on with your work. So these are the two main downsides we experience there today. So hopefully, maybe in a few more moments, we could see it in a more impressive way. But basically that it is for the moment. So what we can do still is, okay, let's get to the galaxy.org site and explore some more tutorials. So you see here there's a propaganda for the Galaxy 101 right on the first image there. This is the one we tried here. And okay, let's see more. So there's an introduction to Galaxy analysis. And there you see some more. There's here material that we can use. The Galaxy 101 was here. This other workflow here from peaks to genes, so the Picus Archenis is also very nice exercise if you want to do that. So it's like basically matching SNPs to QTLs or transcriptomic data comparison. Then you can use this with an instance of IGV, so you get it in the genome browser here. You could also download locally, and then you can basically download the data from Galaxy into your local on your laptop or computer-based IGV browser. Yeah, there's a little bit more here on introduction to genomics and Galaxy and the NGS data logistics. So maybe here this from peaks to genes. Let's see how this was looking. Again, this is a nice little workflow and exercise to go through. Again, we will have to upload here, sorry, the data. Well, in this case, we can upload them from a computer, so let's try this one and see. So we switch back here to our interface, so I put this here also on a separate one. I hope I get not too confused right now. So okay, so here's my Galaxy instance, and so I'm just creating now my new history again. So while this other is hopefully loading, so let's try the second tutorial, peaks to genes, peaks to genes. Okay, so there I get a data set I can download. So okay, I hope it's not too big for my smartphone. Yeah, so okay, let's try this one. Yeah, okay, that seems reasonable. So click on the upload button in the upper left of the interface. So let's try. Okay, here we have our upload button. So okay, I could drag and drop or I can upload, and maybe I make a little bit more space here. Yeah, okay. So I have to choose a local file down here. Data temp projects and today my day, and here is our work file. So that is a file, and then choose local file and select interval as type. Interval as type is over here. So we can also have many types you can upload. So let's interval is this one, and press start, and now this goes yes over my smartphone, but it's manageable, and there we are, it recognized. So this is also a nice very interface. It has multiple options, and one particular one, useful one, is, as we've seen, this one already. But you see here below, there's also FTP. So usually the web browser is only able to load so much megabytes in a go. So if it's more than a few hundred megabytes, maybe a couple of megabytes, 100 megabytes, you should use FTP. And there's a tutorial basically also for the Galaxy browser. So if you have really NGS size data sets to upload, you just use the FTP and they would also show up in the same menu. So then you just have to set your options here, the kind of type and genome, and then you are also ready to go uploading really big data sets. So the only thing, I wouldn't do that obviously over my smartphone, you would have to have a good Wi-Fi or cheap internet connection to upload these data sets. This takes then hours, no, obviously, no? Depending on your internet connection. Anyway, so you can do that. So just, okay, let's press start and press close. So let's do this. Okay, so, okay, here we are. Here is our data set. And again, this is today. Well, it doesn't, it should be turning. This is slower than my smartphone. This is really horrible today. Yeah, this is, okay, still slow. It must be really busy. Anyhow, so, yeah, it should be showing this data set here, and we're still slow. Yeah. Okay, let's see then how this workflow works. So we see on the left-hand side, we have two approaches, the naive approach and the more sophisticated approach to make this matching of. So what we want to do here is to go back. Now we stumbled here, the paper was on histone, or the data came from a paper on histone acetyl transferase AMOF, and it's about possible target genes for an interesting protein called MOF. The targets were obtained by chip sequence in mice, and the raw data is available through this database here. Over the list, however, the list of genes is neither in the paper nor in the geo submissions. So the closest thing they could find here is a file in geo containing a list of the regions where the signal is significantly enriched, the so-called peaks. So the goal of this exercise is to turn the list of genomic regions into a list of possible target genes. So this is kind of an archaeological exercise in bioinformatics. And so let's go on here with, so we have uploaded this data here. We have already created our history. And so let's see what this interval file format was about that we had to assign to the data set here. So it has also these three columns basically, the chromosome ID, and the start and end position in second and third column. So an optional strand column can be when it's not available here. So let's go over to the next point here. Again, we would be able here in the right-hand side to peek into the data and see how they look like. So as we see here, the first three are basically those that were described above. And then we can edit the attributes in the data set. And most importantly, now we know it's from mice, so we have to somehow match this data set to the mouse genome. So we have here the version of the mouse genome that we should use, and the exact version here again. And that we can also set in this attributes page, it is also briefly shown in the first exercise there. And then what is also useful here is that we can add tags to certain data sets. So apart from the name, we can add these tags, and this is then very useful because it will be propagated automatically through the workflow later on into the history. So it makes it easy not to lose track if you have several databases and you transform each data set a little bit, and then you suddenly don't know which one is which one, maybe mistyping the name somewhere down the road, but you still have the tags there, which shows you that you are doing the right thing to the right data sets there. So it is also a very useful thing to, at the very beginning, when you load the data, to also assign a tag. So because then you won't touch the tag, because later on in the history, what Galaxy will automatically add auto-generated names that get longish and longish, and so sometimes they get very long, and you might want, okay, rename this, and you may get confused, and then you have suddenly renamed your genes to your whatever as data set, and it looks confusing. And then you can use a tag to cross-check, you know, whether they are still meaning the same thing. The name you have given and the tag should be supporting that. Okay, so this was one of these additional things in the second exercise. Again, okay, I forgot, this has also data upload from the UCSC. Okay. Yeah, so you see there's also more from mammals. In this case, there's also a mouse genome over there. And we can then use this first approach to go through the contents of this data set. And then what we want to do is here to compare the two files to make sure that the chromosome names follow the same format. Okay, if you can, if we, okay, that was the main issue there, because we see in one file the chromosomes are named. Okay, we see now here, in the one here is 111, and in the second file we have CHR, now for chromosome 1, so are differently named. So if you want to make a match between the two of them, so it's one of the typical problems, we can't do this if they differ in the naming convention. So how do we go about renaming these columns? So as we also recall from our yesterday exercises, don't do it by hand. We should use a tool. So in this case also, Galaxy has lots of different tools for helping you renaming or reorganizing the data. And one of them is just now simply renaming this data so they match to each other, using in this case select last. So these are the first to just check, so like head and tail again. And then in the second part here is adjust the chromosome names with replace text basically. But unlike in Excel, it is being tracked. So we can also, it is also part of the workflow step there officially. And so we can then make the matches easily. You can also search for patterns and replace this. And so here's a way of doing this. So the second file will be renamed so it matches the official naming in the reference genome. So that is another good practice. So you wouldn't usually change the reference. You would change your own data and not the reference. So you adjust the names in the data that you want to match the official standard from the reference genome that you refer to. That makes it easier than also later on in the publication, so people can also see exactly what this is, because everybody should have access to the reference. But if you do it the other way around, you will just create confusion. So the important thing is here, and the last thing is also the gender or sex chromosomes also to be replaced here with the X and Y to basically match chromosome 20 and 21. So the first step here was to prepend, to attach before the numbers always CHR, and then if you had looked at the end of this file, we would see that they have also numbers for chromosome 20 and 21, whereas in the reference genome there are X and Y. So we, in this case, we replace the pattern CHR20 with the CHRX, and for 21 it would be CHRY. So then we have basically here made everything ready for combining those two, or comparing those two data sets. And the objective there was not to match genes to those peaks. So we have here the details on getting the flanks returning for every genes, for every gene, with the following settings here. So this is really difficult to imagine if you don't see it in the this is also not advancing here. Let me see if this other. So I can go back here. Oh, this is not advancing here. No, still the same. So it really appears now this Galaxy Instant today is not the day to make presentations on it. Yeah, anyhow, so we would basically be here in the position to just now make this match, and that's basically it in this first part. Then we can do some more stuff around here to add promoter region to the gene records, not a little bit to amplify our search window basically. And then in this second part, in the following part, better to say, is a format conversion. So this is another, as we have mentioned before, often difficult step to do. So we would here be shown a tool or a way in Galaxy to easily convert between different formats. And then we would have a tool to match basically, basically intersect the two streams of basically the reference and our data to fish out the genes that correspond to the peaks. And so this is difficult to imagine if you don't see it how it's been done. So let's try to keep here. Then the end in mind, and we would have basically here the list of genes and the overlapping peak regions. So then we can do something more. We can count the genes on the different chromosomes, and also we can then make a nice bar chart on how this distribution is. And again, at the end, we extract the workflow for this one. So this one is also then easy to reuse, and important to reuse because like this matching of peaks and genes is like a very generic approach that can be used for other types of data like transcriptome data and so on. And again, we have here our workflow editing. Okay, yeah, it's very sad. This is not really working today on on Galaxy. Okay, I think it's time for coffee break right now. Or are we? Yeah. So let's hope for the best, and maybe we still have some chance here to. Oh, okay, there's something is happening here on our first one. So let's break for coffee and hope the other one will also be coming up. Yeah, switch to, okay, so we were not abandoned. So the good news is as we have one here, so we can at least now view our data. Okay, there we are. So we have here chromosome 22, start and end. And so hopefully shortly after coffee, we will have now access to our second data set. So it works, but with a delay.